I'd like to welcome everybody this morning. I ask the clerk to do the roll call.
Mr. Conover?
Here.
Mr. Leggett?
Here.
Mr. Gerard?
Here.
Mr. McDevitt?
Here.
Ms. Bramer?
Here.
Mr. Brock?
Here.
Mr. McDonald?
Here.
Mr. Frazier?
Here.
Mr. Simpson?
Here.
Mr. Bantolo?
Here.
Mr. Dickinson?
Here.
Mr. Merlino?
Here.
Mr. Strau?
Here.
Ms. Siever?
Here.
Mr. Beattie?
Here.
Mr. Montesi?
Here.
Mr. Sokol?
Here.
Mr. Thomas?
Here.
Ms. Wood?
Here.
Chairman Garrity?
Here. Motion to accept the March 18th meeting of the board subject to correction. Motion by Supervisor Wood. Second. Second by Supervisor Bantolo. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Carried. Chairman's report. We finished up March, had many meetings with the outgoing administrator, learned many things that hadn't been involved in before, health insurance reserves. We went to an inter-county meeting in Franklin County at Paul Smith College, very interesting. Attended an AATV meeting in Indian Lake. And we'll discuss that a little bit more later on in our report. I had a meeting with the county administrator and the sheriff's department on reverse 911 messaging and with the purchasing department on ghost cards, which I think I touched a little bit on. Those are the purchasing cards we use. And ghost cards are where you make big purchases on credit cards and you get money back from the bank. When you make purchases, that would be used for like paving, paving materials or salt or something like that. It's a plan that the county got into under Paul and Julie. And I went to committee meetings, met with the Department of Social Services, and I spoke to the committee about the direct energy representative. We talked about the decatherms for the natural gas, which we signed the contract. I had a department head meeting with department heads after the exit of the former administrator, and I laid out my expectations to the department heads, and I think it's pretty well received so far. They've been doing a very good job. Department heads and employees have been doing a very good job since the transformation into what we're doing now. I went to the traffic safety board meeting. I'm sure everybody read in the paper where the DWI patrols are working. A fewer arrests for DWI, which is a good thing, and we should look at it as a positive. I know the sheriff will continue doing what he will do, and the city will continue doing what they do on somewhat a limited basis. Also, that day, I went to the Personnel Finance Committee, had a meeting, a couple meetings with Social Services Department. Dan Gerard and I had another meeting with the Warren County Historical Society, and we continue to talk on the Gurney Lane property. And I've had several meetings with Brian. I had meetings with various county departments, human resources, county clerk, sign council, county attorney, clerk of the board one day. And then more meetings with Brian. We've got a lot going on. Human Resource Director, and myself, Larry Palkowicz, we talked about various labor issues. We're trying to put to bed any former grievances we've had with CSEA. I think we're getting close to putting in a period on those. And then Matt Sokol and I met with Dee Park on Countryside Adult Home, and Matt will have more of that in his report. And then the last 2 days I've been in Lake Placid attending the APA Local Government Day, and Edna was there, Evelyn was there, Matt was there, Ron Basil was there, and Craig was there. And one of the meetings I focused on with several of my colleagues in Edna, we focused on broadband because we've been getting mixed messages about broadband. And I challenged the speaker that was from the governor's office on broadband about what we're being told and what's really going to happen with this broadband initiative. The initiative is everybody's supposed to have broadband by 2017 across the whole state. And that's pretty aggressive. And one of the things they hang their hat on is this Charter Time Warner merger, which is going to, it's still in the Public Service Commission's hands. They haven't approved it yet, or the FCC. And one of the things Time Warner has to do is they have to provide broadband to 140 households that currently don't have it. And when we initially went to a meeting with Warren County EDC, myself, Sergeant County, and a few others, we got the impression that our underserved areas in Warren County weren't going to see any of this initial round of funding. Well, the guy from the state says that's not true, and we went up afterwards and met with him, and we have his phone number. Myself and Gene Merlino was there as my muscle, and we went up there, and we had a meeting with him afterwards, and we're going to call the guy, but I would tell you, all the supervisors who represent all the towns, if you have areas that are underserved, you need to, I would go to our GIS office or Ed Bartholomew and find out the streets, the roads, the number of people that are underserved currently with no broadband, and get that list together so we can give it to the state directly. Because I've seen maps that show, and I think I spoke about this a month ago, I've seen maps that show that Warren County is has service. We don't have service. We don't have service in Thurman. We don't have service in Stony Creek. We don't have service in some of the roads in town of Warrensburg. And I think it affects everybody. So what I would do is make a concerted effort in the next month or so to get the name of your streets, get how many people on your streets, and we'll get together a list. And we'll present it to the state on our own without relying on the bigger picture to see if we can't get some of these homes. It was a good meeting. And like I said, I think all the communities, we all suffer from the same issues. And I was happy we asked a question because I think we got some clarity. Now, the big picture is once we get these lists to the state, if anything happens. Did I miss anything, Gene or Matt or Edna or whoever was in there with us? Did we cover that pretty well? Yeah, that was before. Yes,
I think so long ago, I think our planning office.
We did.
Actually, Matt.
Absolutely.
Matt the county on it. I think we should use that map.
Right. The problem is they. We understand that. You know, Brian was involved, and that's what we told the people from the state, but it depends on how they use that information. So that's why he suggested that we get our own information and we forward it right to the state office and say, here's the communities, here's the roads, here's the number of people who don't have internet right now. So we could probably grab a lot of that over there. You're right, Ron. The other thing I'd like to mention is people with anniversaries. Brian Engel in the Sheriff's Department, 30 years. Susan Campbell in the Sheriff's Department, 30 years. George Dunkley in DPW, 30 years. Wanda Olden, Countryside, 25 years. And Diane Field in Public Health, 15 years. So congratulations to those people with their anniversaries. And I try to hit anybody over 15 years. So we appreciate their service. I have no report for the administrator. It's a dual report, so we'll go to the report by the county attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a couple items that are embodied in resolutions and a couple that are going to be floor resolutions. The first of them is an amendment, proposed local law number 3 of 2016. It is an amendment to the, man is going to pass that out. It is simply an amendment to the local fireworks law that would provide specifically that no local law is superseded by this. An intent to address any question that may arise regarding transit merchant laws or zoning laws so that no one gets the idea that if they have the ability to sell these items in a tent or other temporary facility that they don't have to pay attention to zoning laws or transit merchant laws. It just is a clarification of that. The other thing that I have is a floor resolution that will be passed out to authorize and ratify a proposed agreement with the lieutenants at the sheriff's office, an extension of their collective bargaining agreement. We discussed the terms in the committee meeting. If people want specific information about those terms, because it is still pending this board's authority, then we would have to go into executive session. If you don't want any more specifics than we provided in the committee, then we would be able to do that without an executive session. There's also a resolution in there, 187, a settlement of a claim against the sheriff pending in federal court. Again, we discussed the terms of that. It is to be a confidential settlement. This resolution would provide for us to pay our insurance deductible of $25,000 to the carrier and the chairman to execute the settlement agreements. And finally, 197, the one-month extender of our contract that we currently have with the Legal Aid Society that provides for conflict defender services and family court here in Warren County. The contract expires on the 30th. We want to negotiate a new contract. They want some more money. In the interim, well, we can do that and get through committee. I thought it prudent to agree to their services for 1 month more on the same terms. Thank you.
Okay, now, Peter, you want to start with this?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of quick things. One had to do with some information that was in today's Post Star, and it had to do with the New York State Authority's Budget Office has concluded that a review of our EDC in Warren County in response to a complaint regarding a land sale in the Queensbury Business Park, and fundamentally the review raised no substantive objections to the real estate transaction. It had to do primarily with the Hacker boat sale that sold for $75,000 and 17 acres within the Queensbury Business Park. At the end of the day, I believe what the board found is that although the sale of the piece of property was below fair market value, they believe that it was permissible since the sale was consistent with the mission of creating jobs. I think a complaint was registered, a conclusion was reached, and at the end of the day, I think what the board found is that accountability, transparency, and integrity are very important, and that in the future, public meetings have to be adhered to more aggressively to ensure public trust. My second item, briefly, had to do with an email I think we all have received very recently from Amy Clute, and it had to do with her feeling that we potentially may be going down a dangerous road as far as economic viability is in Warren County as it relates to volunteer firefighters, in Warren County. And it has to do with someone who enters the firefighter service and someone who is subsequently diagnosed with cancer in the performance of their job as a volunteer fireman. The net result of this, and let me paraphrase from this document, the legislation, which I believe has been passed in the New York State Senate and is waiting for a sponsor in our New York State Assembly, such legislation would essentially place counties in the position of ensuring that in the event that a volunteer firefighter contracts cancer of any kind, that they will need to provide indemnity, medical, and potentially death benefits unless they can prove that such cancer condition is unrelated with competent advice. Providing such a presumption and placing the cost of rebutting such a presumption on county taxpayers would pose an undue financial burden and hardship. Again, I think this is going down a road that could be very, very expensive in the future. And I would hope that jointly would consider opposing this effort in the New York State legislature. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a quick comment on Resolution 196 about passing new legislation to take off of the counties the unfunded mandate to increase the judicial salaries. And I'm glad that's in there, and I thank you for that.
Yeah, we had a lot of conversation about that, and actually some of them, and Speck was up there, but Assemblyman Mark Butler, who represents the Adirondacks, I spoke to him yesterday about that and said, Mark, what's up with this? And he did make overtures that it was the worst budget season they ever had in Albany, and I really don't know a lot that's included in here, but he assured me that it would be taken up and that it would be paid for by the state. But it doesn't look that way, but that's what he said. Because we're all concerned about that. Every county that's represented up there is concerned about this. Supervisor Brock?
Yes, I'd like to make a suggestion for the fireworks resolution that, I don't know how many of you follow football, but Jason Pierpaul and the New York Giants last year blew his fingers off. It would be perhaps a good thing to put a picture when people go to buy fireworks, they see what happens when you're not careful with fireworks. And I'm saying that somewhat facetiously, but actually if he, now that I'm thinking about it, might not actually be a bad idea to see if he would, not for the county, but for the state, you know, promote something like that. And at least, you know, kids, boys particularly know about Jason Pierre-Paul, and if they saw what happens when you hold a firework, you know, what all happens to him. He makes $10 million a year, and he may have destroyed his career. He's going to play one more year and see if he can do it with half a hand. Anyway, that's my 2 cents for the month, and as we, whatever.
Thank you, sir. Supervisor McDonald?
No report.
Supervisor Perkins?
No report.
Supervisor Simpson?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Public Works met on March 28th, and we started the meeting with Justin Gagneau. He thanked all the supervisors who had shown their support for the railroad contract extension. And then he introduced Robert Hart, CEO of Renegade Riders, who gave us a PowerPoint presentation about their operation, which offers rail biking, which is a possibility on our railroad. Then the floor was extended to Wayne Lamont, county planner, and we distributed a conceptual framework for the First Wilderness Trail, Corinth to Hawes. This is a plan that's been in the works since originally in 2002, with a goal of providing a bicycle trail along the river rail corridor. Then we heard from Paul Butler about the Up Yonder Pancake Breakfast Maple Festival, which had been attended by 150 guests. We approved a resolution number 176, which is a new contract with Spectra Engineering and Architecture and Surveying for periodic professional structural engineering services. Then we're on to resolution 175, which is amending a resolution number 616 from 2015, awarding bid and authorizing agreement with CARE Environmental Corporation for hazardous household waste collection, which is a program that's been funded up to $50,000. That's with a DEC grant. We have resolution 172, which is a county highway preservation project on County Route 17, 52, and 79. And 173 is a new contract with Creighton Manning Engineering for construction inspection services in correlation with a preservation project County Route 17, 52, and 79. Lastly, resolution 174 was approval of a request from Dog and Pup Hot Dog Cart to set up in the county right-of-way near exit 24 in the town of Warrensburg, subject to approval by town of Warrensburg for the month of July and August, and also Labor Day weekend. My report. Thank you.
Supervisor Vansel.
Well, Sport Services met on the 23rd of March and represented by the following resolution. 179 is agreeing to provide chainsaw safety training with or without staff. Well, the brochure you just got confused me because this guy doesn't have any staff on it. But maybe he has a steel man. Also, 180 is authorizing the continuation of the Farm to Desk program at Juniper Hill Farm. one is authorizing contract for background check. 182 is some changes to the county's police policy. And 183 is authorizing support for state action to amend our mortgage recording tax. So that is the case.
Thank you. Supervisor Gibson?
I have a lengthy report. Maybe this guy's got two prosthetics.
From the last
time he did that. Environmental concerns and real property. Real property, we approved the contract for printing of the tax map. That's resolution 167. 168 is a list of corrections to the assessment roll. And that concludes my report. Thank you.
Supervisor Marino.
I have a short one also. A resolution 171 from the Traffic Safety Board is to reappoint people back on that board. Mr. Garrity appointed. And the only thing on a comment on the Traffic Safety Board, and you mentioned it and it was in the paper, it's a shame that we have to cut a budget because the money that runs the budget of the Traffic Safety Board comes from fines of people on DWI, and it's down about 50% in the last 4 years, and it's very, it's an amazing feat that that happens, and it's a shame we have to cut our budget a little, and so I'm going to try to get with the budget officer this year to see if we can maybe get some funding for that so we don't lose out on those patrols. I think they're doing a great job, and they got to continue. The tourism did not meet last month, but a lot went on. We're working on our commercials right now. And we did sign the contract with BB&G a couple weeks ago, and we're sending them a ton of information that they're looking for. They're going to analyze a lot of that and then come up here for a while and go around our county and move on with this process. But it's, and I just want to express to some of the supervisors and some of the business people, it's going to take 4, 5, 6 months before we get anything out of them. So we get a lot of calls of tourism, when is it going to happen, so from the business people, but it's going to take some time, but it will get done. The only other thing, I stopped at exit 17 rest area of the Chamber of Saratoga, Lake George had an open house on their exit 18 project. They really did a great job. It looks good. It's clean. A lot of monitors on the wall, a lot of technology in there. And we just got to continue supporting them and keep that. You all know that the state's going to put in $1 million to refurbish that rest area, so that's going to be a nice gateway to our county. Under O&M, the only thing we have is resolution 169. It's to amend one resolution 531 from 2003 to an intermunicipal agreement with the Village of Lake George, and to include the State Department of State grant funding. And that's all I have. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Strout.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Legislative and Rules Committee met on March 28th. There's two resolutions before you tonight that came out of that committee. Resolution 170, which speaks to criminal legal defense services and the payment therein. It we strongly support providing defense counsel in criminal cases against people unable to afford counsel. However, we also support state reimbursement for that. We think it's another unfunded mandate, and this resolution is to ask the state for funding for that matter. Resolution 195, the committee did discuss that to some length and decided that that discussion would be more appropriate with the full board. So it's before you this afternoon, possibly for discussion. And the other resolution I wish to speak to, I think is more appropriate speaking to that at the time of the reading of resolution. Okay, and so that's it for me. Thank you.
Supervisor Seaver.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I have a few items to report on. This week, as we all know, is National Crime Victims' Rights Week. I did attend a breakfast on Monday morning. There we honored, Warren County honored five individuals, including our court officers, so it was a nice recognition of all their hard work. Washington County was nice enough to include us in their proclamation and announced that we approved our own proclamation, but it was hosted in Washington County, so they did include us in that, which was nice. And then, secondly, as it relates to the Higher Education Committee, we did finally set criteria for the annual recognition award. And just briefly, our committee will be taking a look at those nominees that are sent over and selected by the college. As a committee, you will have the opportunity to choose that honoree. The criteria is to overcome obstacles while pursuing their education, as well as strong academic achievement, a Warren County resident, and exhibiting motivation, tenacity, and enthusiasm. So we'll have an opportunity to look at those at our next committee meeting, and we will eventually recognize them at a board meeting as well as at graduation. Also, I had an opportunity to meet with our HR department. I just want to thank Jackie, she's up here, but we had a lengthy discussion regarding various issues, but as it relates to the performance work, performance evaluation committee. So we're starting to look at some documents and some drafts along with the chairman to come up with a draft that could be proposed to you at a future date for a committee meeting. And then lastly, I'm continuing to work both with the town of Queensbury and with our county attorney and our chairman of personnel and finance as it relates to what is in fact the county law which established our at-large position in 1966. At the time we had three positions. At first glance, we all thought that was established by the town, but in fact, at that point in time, there was just about 8,000 residents in Queensbury, and we had our weighted vote was 36. We know now we have a weighted vote of 85, and we have nearly 30,000 people. So we saw amendments in that law over the years, in 1971 and 1981 being the last amendment. But my point of bringing this up is that we are the only representatives that actually fall under the jurisdiction of the county as at-large. So the town has the ability to fill a vacancy, but does not have the ability to change the structure of our positions or even to have that discussion. So we are meeting with the town council along with at-large supervisors to have a discussion about requesting the county to either A, turn that jurisdiction over to the town, that would have to be a full board resolution, or B, continue in the fashion that we're currently within and come before you for any change of our position. So it was interesting to find out that it was in fact a county law and the town does not have the jurisdiction, unlike the city charter or all of their supervisor positions. And that's it.
Supervisor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As chairman of the Shared Services Committee, I had Amanda send out an email to everyone asking are there any relevant topics that they could see us consolidating on and possibly saving, i.e. the town or the county money through purchasing of larger quantities. And I did receive emails back from three or four supervisors. I appreciate that. I'm planning a committee meeting not this coming month, but the month after. And there's some issues with or potential savings after talking with our purchasing department, that if the town's got more involved with getting the information to the county, there could possibly be some savings for the towns as well as the county. So anyway, just please be aware of that. And if you've got any other ideas in which you want to see potential cost savings to your town, feel free to email me or call me. And I also am in support of the fact that we had that unfunded mandate for the raise that is totally disrespectful for the counties to put another unfunded mandate. And you have a proclamation in there, and that I'm in total support of that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ron?
No report, Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Sokol.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Health, Human, and Social Services met on March 23rd. We had a relatively light agenda. Mental health and youth and employment did not meet. They didn't have anything on their docket. That left us with public health, social services, countryside, and Office of the Aging. There are resolutions in your packet, 163 through 166. They are basic authorizations of grants, agreements with Warren and Hamilton counties, and a 2016 annual plan that was written up by Social Services. Resolution 188 deals strictly with my committee, and it is all about creating new positions, reducing some hours we had at Countryside. We also had a deleting of a position at Social Services, and they constantly come up with creative ideas to better their department as well as the needs of the community. And this is one of them. In fact, they're deleting one position of a social welfare examiner, but also bringing on an intake clerk and two caseworkers, so that better suits the needs of the community. Also, we have a temporary position that Pat Auer and Public Health would like to create. It's only for 90 days, but we do need to amend that. Is this the proper time to do so, or do I bring that up in the resolutions? Right now, the salary was close to $69,000. Pat realized that the incoming supervisor does not have the experience that the other director or the other nurse had. So our human resources director did a study and felt that the $66,000 was a justifiable request. So I don't know whether I should bring that up right now or...
We can do that in resolutions, I think. Well, because I know other people have want to speak to resolutions.
Okay. And lastly, I have one other item, but the chairman did mention that we did meet with Dee at Countryside. And we probably will bring this to committee. But it was a nice, relaxed conversation that we had with her, and we had it a few weeks prior with Social Services, with Maureen and Cynthia. I feel we may do more of these, but it kind of brought out a problem that was up at the at the home that I think we can help. Last week, Dee was quite ill. She was out for the entire week. The census right now is down at Countryside, and we had nobody to interview some of these potential residents. So we're going to bring it to committee, but we're thinking about maybe hiring a part-time person who can do those interviews and hopefully bring up our census. And finally, it was brought up at committee that Queensborough resident Travis had some questions on our per monthly payments to Siemens. I did reach out to Larry. He was not available to come today. I will try to get him to the next committee meeting. But Brian, I don't know if you want to add to this at all. But
thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks, Supervisor. I am comfortable at the moment that our rights are protected as far as the ongoing payments we're making to Siemens, and that we're receiving reimbursement from centers for the appropriate payments. Also, that the maintenance services, that question is has been addressed, and between Mr. Paltrowitz and the attorney for centers, you know, I believe we are protected in regard to that as well. And the remaining payment, the $700 and change per month for the performance guarantee, we are continuing to make that based on the sense of the board at believe the February meeting. So I'm up to speed on what payments we're making, what reimbursements we're getting, and I believe we are acting appropriately to protect the county's interests and our stance if there's litigation.
And Matt, I didn't know if you wanted to speak a little bit about the Child Abuse Prevention Month. They're having a service over at front of the Human Services Building at 1:30 today.
Right.
I missed it because I got back late, but I know many of you have blue shirts on, which is for child abuse. So. Anybody who can make it at 1:30, that would be great, and hopefully some of you on the committee can make it over there. So,
that's my report.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Supervisor Thomas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. No report.
Okay. Supervisor Wood.
Thank you, Chairman. We met on March 23rd, last month. Most of it was basic housekeeping and extending contracts. Resolutions 158 through 162. Are reflective of that, and we also had a presentation from emergency services that lasted about an hour with regards with declarations for disasters and that sort of thing. Other than that, that's all I have to report. Thank you.
Okay, we have, yes, we have to continue.
for a second. Finance met on the 31st of March, representing your package by resolutions 156, 157, and 184 through 194. Many of them have already been discussed, but I would bring to your attention resolution 186. I think it's important to identify this resolution. This is an extremely significant resolution. It was an action that was recommended by the county treasurer some time back, actually, by Mike Swan. Mike, if you could come to the podium, perhaps. What's really truly significant about this, I think, is good news and bad news. The good news is that we find ourselves in a financial position to be able to increase the required amount of unassigned balance, fund balance, that we have to maintain from, I believe, $6 million presently to $9 million. And so the good news is that we find ourselves in a financial position to be able to do that. If there's a downside to doing it, it's that it would make these dollars unavailable for future budgets because they're going to be needed for cash flow purposes within the budget. But Mike, I know you asked for this some time back, and I just thought perhaps you should maybe comment on this and the significance of doing this.
Well, you hit the nail on the head. This is a cash flow thing. The county needs X number of dollars on hand to pay our bills every month. And if you look at it just a simple math approach, we have $125 to $130 million a year in expenditures. You divide that by, you know, 12 months, you're talking $9 or $10 million a month in expenditures. Most of the time we have enough cash flow, but there are certain times of the year, especially January, February, and March, where we have nothing coming in, basically, and we need that money sitting there to make sure that we can pay our bills, pay the salaries, pay the light, pay everything else. This is, I guess I said in the committee meeting, you know, this is an alarm, okay, so that everybody knows that if we get close to that point, we have some financial problems, right? Right now we're doing fine. We have a fund balance that's very healthy. We're working on the closing of last year, and it looks like it's going to be good, down just a little bit, but I think we're still going to be in good shape. But this is a safety valve. This is to let everybody know down the road that, hey, we get to this level, we've got some problems. We're going to be running out of money. And if we run out of money, if I don't have enough money to pay the bills, I have to go borrow it, and that's expensive, and we don't need to be doing that.
Now, the upper end of this, the $16 million, If our fund balance should rise, hopefully it will, but above that $16 million, then it would be required, unattended, it would require the any amount above that to be applied to the proposed budget. Is that correct?
Yeah. I mean, if we clear that amount, then that money it should be put back in. You know, because then we're holding, I think, in my opinion anyway, and I'm glad to see that most of you agree, we're holding too much of the taxpayers' money. We need to push that back into the budget to help that. Yes.
And just for everyone's information, the amount of, Frank, the amount of unassigned fund balance that was allocated in this year's budget was approximately how much?
I think it was about $500,000.
Yeah.
$500,000. So, and that's significant because that fills a revenue part of our budget to go against the expense. If that gets to be too high, then it can create future problems in successive years in finding those dollars, particularly if the revenue picture changes to the negative. So, I feel comfortable with this resolution, and I recommend for its adoption. Thank you, Mike.
I really can't answer that because we're still trying to close the books. That'll be another probably 2 weeks. Yeah, well, you know, I don't want to give you what I have a good idea what it is, but I don't want to say that until we get everything closed up. We were at about $14 million the previous year. We're going to be a little bit less than that, but not much.
Mike.
Yes.
Mike, these aren't these are somewhat hard caps, but they're not hard caps. So if we fall below this, we're not going to automatically go out and borrow money if we fall below.
No. I mean, and the ceiling
for guidance.
Yeah, I mean, we're the current resolution that we're operating under says 6 to 12 million,
right.
And I mean, we've been over 12 million for several years.
Right.
So I mean, it's like I said, it's more of an alarm system, okay, to let everybody know that when we get to that level, we've got to, we meaning the board and us, we need to start saying, well, wait a minute, look at this again, see where we're at and what's going on, because that it can trigger. It won't automatically trigger. It could trigger borrowing.
Okay.
Ready? I'd also quickly point to your attention, Resolution 187, that was reported in the media as well. That's that settlement that was we previously discussed. And I just for the supervisor's information, because there was discussion of finance regarding a budget transfer relative to a performance report to Siemens. It's my understanding that I was planning on bringing to the committee, but it's my understanding that that transfer legislation is not required. And based on my conversation with the chairman, is that monthly guarantee will be paid. That's correct. So that's why you don't see that legislation. And that concludes my report.
Supervisor Leggett.
I have nothing.
I just had a question
in what we just discussed with the treasurer. That fund balance appropriation of $9 million for cash flow purposes, could it be construed or looked at that with the less than $14 million that we have, with the passage of this resolution, therefore we really only have less than $5 million in fund balance effectively use because that's the $9 million has been appropriated and cannot be touched.
The fund balance is used for cash flow purposes. Where it really applies is, for example, the year-end report that Mike's preparing, that the auditors are presently preparing. Within that report, they will reconcile everything, and there'll be a column line in that report that actually tells us what our year-end unassigned fund balance is. And so for this resolution, each year that's going to need to be $9 million or more so that the treasurer knows he has sufficient cash going into the next year to handle the cash flow so that we don't have to be short from borrowing to handle our cash flow. In other words, we're financing our own cash flow. So those dollars are utilized. But they're not assigned for an expenditure that's not being retrieved. In other words, for example, if he has estate money that he's expecting, he's got cash going in and cash going out, those dollars are replaced.
My concern is the extravagance of a possible like Route 11 washout where we have millions of dollars of unanticipated expenses that have to be taken care of immediately. We have extremely poor weather through the summer. Our sales tax plummets, and we don't meet our revenue sourcing for budgets. You know, my point is, are we looking at the little less than $5 million of only usable money that we could to cover those extravagances because we have to have $9 million appropriated for the movement forward?
In terms of a capital project like a washout, the answer to your question would be yes, because we wouldn't be expecting any revenue on that. In terms of declining revenue like sales tax or something like that, where it would apply is that you would only have up to $5 million to apply against the next year's operating budget to be able to compensate for that. So we have, for example, applied varying levels of fund balance over the years within the budget to balance our budget from a revenue picture. Memory serves me, even in recent years, it was considerably more than half a million, Frank.
Yeah, a couple of years ago, it was over 2.5.
It was over 2.5, and so we take all of our revenue, and then we take what revenue we're going to take out of the fund balance to balance the budget. And what's happened over in more recent years is, and it's a good thing, is to try to get that application of that fund balance down to as small as possible, because that's like a savings account. That's not recurring. That's not recurring revenue. It's not, in other words, that's revenue that once you deplete it, the only way to increase the fund balance is through a positive cash flow. Jim saying, to replenish it, get to the year end, and your revenue exceeds your expenditure. Revenue doesn't exceed expenditures, then you can't replenish your fund balance. So you need to think of it like savings accounts. So what this legislation does is basically saying we're setting $9 million, and we don't want a bonus sign revenue be in the budget to take care of our cash requirements. We're not going to go below that amount.
Yeah. Supervisor Wood,
yeah. I think what Supervisor Girard is asking, although we did find it would be a very good response, Ron, is something a little bit more simple. Basically, by passing this, if we have an emergency, have we restricted ourselves from using our fund balance? And the simple answer to that is no. We could always simply change our fund balance policy and access our cash in our fund balance if we needed to, say we did have a washout or something like that. This is more, I think, to make it very, very simple, just guidance so that we can keep enough cash on hand so the treasurer's not borrowing to make the bills. But if we had an emergency, we could certainly suspend the policy and go forward and do what we needed to do, because we'd be doing a number of resolutions anyway in that instance. I hope that's somewhat helpful.
Because conversely, if it was opposite, and we couldn't do that, we're only looking
then
at
we'd think
$5 million,
about doing
and, that, and just a couple events could really flip-flop our budget process around. And
right. If you
exactly
remember right, when we were in trouble, Frank would come and ask to borrow $6 million in January, February to meet payroll.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the shorter answer is the money's still there. But we'd go against our resolution on the bottom cap.
Yeah.
We're not broke, but we just need to pay.
And I understand, you know, we're doing this to circumvent so we don't have to do that borrowing. And,
right,
you know, it's
and
good,
the reason why
it's good practice and policy.
He raised the bottom up is because we did have more money on hand, so we were kind of,
yeah.
But we are everybody's piggy bank, too. Just remember that. We are the school district's piggy bank. We are the town's piggy bank, because in January, you know, the county ends up paying all the shortfalls to the towns that you accumulate. And I don't know when you pay the school districts.
Just to give you an idea, we're going to be on the deck for about $6.5 million for non-paid taxes back to the town.
Right, but when do you pay the school districts too, though?
We make the payments to them. They can pay the money for the return.
So we are the piggy bank for everybody.
But there is just a cautionary note that it's guidance, but it's also the moment you go into that for any reason, you create other implications within the budget, either from the perspective from the borrowing relative to the it's a time that we would have to consider that there'd be other just the implications of doing that versus just to get by there while it's going to our fund balance. $5 million now, the issue then becomes whether we can cash flow purposes. So it's guidance, but it's good guidance.
Okay, do you have a report?
Yes. It's quick, I think. We have two resolutions in the packet, 177, 178. 177 is for authorizing Town of Warren to construct a water well, which they have several already on the countrywide property where Cornell is also in. We're okaying that for the Town of Warrensburg to put another well in there. 178 is changing some sources of funding into another account because we had a retirement, and this would be for this would go to Height and Beaumont, which would be representing us in the related airport eminent domain relating to Forest Enterprises. So it's just shifting it to another legal entity. Cornell has, this is April 15th, the magic tax day, and I don't know if the doctor has a report on how well the VITA program does. I know each year you do give us a little bit. This is a really good program where they do taxes for free for those people that can use it, and they bring in millions to the county.
Yeah, I really don't have a final report yet, probably next month on the tax on the VITA program, but I know we served over 300 refunds, and last year we brought back over $1 million into the county, so that program continues to thrive. I did have a point of clarification. Thanks, Ron, for bringing it up. You have a pamphlet, Chainsaw Safety, and it's different than 179 in your packet. About a month ago, Amy Kloop contacted me and asked about chainsaw safety because she knows we provided it for the loggers. So I got on the line and I actually found some grant money to provide what's in this packet, an introductory to chainsaw safety. It'll be free of charge. I set up two classes, May 9th, and the Warren County Town and Highway Departments are going to be offered this class free of charge, and I think it's something that they would benefit from. It's only a few hours, but chainsaw can be a very dangerous instrument. So that is going to be offered for free. So any of you who have highway workers who haven't had anything, this is a good thing. What Amy is offering here is a more advanced chainsaw safety, the one that's really provided to most loggers, and that's Bill Lindoff and ProCuts. So I just wanted to distinguish that this one is available to all highway workers. It's free, and this one is for other folks.
Thank you, Mr. And lastly, I would have liked to give a report on the courts, because the plans have been drawn by Clark Patterson. They've been tweaked, and they're being reviewed by the courts, and we're waiting for that approval so that we could put this out to bid. I thought Jeff would be here, and possibly we were hoping by today that it could announce that we're going out to bid. It's very close, and but I'm sorry I don't have an answer definitively about the review and if it's happened, etc. This is one of the things we've been running into, trying to get the I's dotted and the T's crossed so that we can move forward. Our end of it is done. Our engineers have prepared the packet. We're ready to do this, and we're just waiting for the state of New York and the court, Office of Court Administration, to give us the final approvals to move on. We're in very good shape with the architect who reviews everything, and everything looks great. It's just the formality of getting that okay. Thank you.
Supervisor Vandal, did you have your answer?
I just want to ask him if that's the introductory course, if that's those curious courses, learn how to put the tabs on in the intermediate course.
Thank you, Ron. No, you're going to learn in this course. Definitely.
Okay.
Also in your packet, you have three proclamations and Mental Health Month in May, Law Day in Warren County, and Older American Month. And those are also included in your packet. Reading communication.
We have reports of criminal and family workloads for February 2016 from the Warren County Probation Department, PROACT Warren County Discount Card Utilization Report for January 2015 through March 2016, Adirondack Community College Annual Report for the year ended August 31, 2015. We have minutes from the January 19th and February 17th, 2016 meetings of the Warren, Washington County CDC, and the February 9th and 17th, 2016 meetings of the Warren, Washington County IDA. Capital District Regional Off-Track Bedding Corp. February 2016 surcharge check in the amount of $4,584. Letter from Siemens Building Technologies dated March 15th, 2016 regarding West Mountain Health Facility Performance Contracting Agreement, which was emailed to all members of the Board of Supervisors on March 18th. Letter from Travis Whitehead, Town of Queensbury resident, to Thomas Foley of Siemens Building Technologies, dated March 20th, 2016, regarding Siemens contracts with Warren County. This was emailed to all members of the Board of Supervisors on March 22nd. We have a letter from the North Creek Business Alliance stating support for renewal of the contract with Saratoga North Creek Railway. And we have Town of Queensbury Resolution Number 141 of 2016, setting public hearing for a proposed local law to amend Queensbury Town Code Chapter 179 zoning to establish commercial intensive Exit 18 zoning district to rezone certain areas and revise the town zoning map.
That's it. Okay, we're going to read resolutions, and I know several of you want to comment on resolutions, but Amanda, go ahead.
Resolution number 156 through 195 were mailed. Resolution numbers 156 and 157 were amended after mailing. Printed copies of these revised resolutions are included in your folders. They were also distributed by email and posted to the county website. A motion is needed to approve the amendments to those two.
We have a motion by Supervisor Simpson, second by Supervisor Merlino. Any other discussion on that? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Resolution number 196 and 197 were prepared after the resolutions were mailed. Printed copies of those are included in your folders, and they were also distributed via email and posted to the county website earlier in the week. A motion is needed to bring proposed resolutions number 196 and 197 to the floor, as well as the resolution proposed by Mr. Reichenbach regarding authorization of a successor public employment agreement, and the resolution proposed by Supervisor Strau to introduce proposed local law number 3 of 2016.
Motion by Supervisor Brammer. Do we have a second? Second by Supervisor Montesi. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed.
Okay. The resolution authorizing the successor public employment agreement effective through December 31, 2017 is number 198. And the resolution introducing local law number 3 of 2016 is 199.
Okay. Now we'll have discussion on resolutions, and I need to ask for a roll call vote on 177. That's the well. So now we'll go down through any discussion on resolutions. Supervisor Strau.
Yes, I don't know if it becomes resolution 198, Amanda, the resolution that I wish to bring forward.
It's numbered as 199.
199. Yeah. All right. I think many of us can remember the days where tractor trailers would drive up and down Route 9 especially, but the side streets, anywhere they could pull off, and they'd unload their contents, sometimes from Mexico, and there was beautiful velvet paintings of Elvis Presley and so forth. I'm sure many of you have those still hanging in your living room. But they would present serious traffic issues because they weren't fully pulled off from the side of the road, or if they were pulled off into some closed building that had a parking lot that was unsafe to the public, and there was in and out traffic that was unsafe to the public. We, being the town of Queensbury, along with many of you, adopted transit merchant laws.
Right.
And the intent of those transit merchant laws, if I may, and you may refer to it by another name, wish to assure that those transient merchants that come into our area will not cause undue hardship to adjoining property owners and or to the public and or have undue traffic impacts. So many of the towns in Warren County, we wish to maintain the integrity of our transient merchant laws, or whatever you have that might be similar but called by a different name. And we want to reserve the right to approve these transient merchant activities. And if approved, condition our approval so that the size of the event is limited and fits in with the site in which they're proposing to occur. The parking is satisfactory and safe for the public, that hours of operation don't hinder, you know, adjacent properties, that that there are parking constraints and that we limit those parking constraints and they abide by those parking constraints, and that they maintain insurance and or a bond. And if they need facility improvements, we would tell them, okay, you can locate here, but this is what you need to do to make it safe for the public and make it less harmful to the adjoining property owners and so forth. So that's the intent of our merchant law. And so we just want to make it clear to those people who wish to come in to sell fireworks that no law, even our county law that allows fireworks, is meant to supersede or take away the protection that our municipal laws offer in terms of transient merchants. So that is a clarification, and I would support your approval on that matter. Thank you.
Thank you. Supervisor Thomas.
Yeah, I have a question on Resolution 169. The intermunicipal agreement amendment with the Village of Lake George. I don't see a source of funding for the county's 62% local match on this grant. I was just wondering if somebody could just refresh my memory as to where that money might be coming from.
Well, if you want, the only thing I, that's the grant that the mayor got.
Right.
I don't even know if there's a match on that, to be honest with you.
Well, the resolution says there's $124,000 local match, county share.
But a county share.
Right.
I can't answer that question, I'll be honest.
Is that covered by the fees at the park, the parking lot fees, or is it covered by the Wood Foundation, or?
I have to say yes to that, but I'm not 100% sure.
Okay.
It's not coming out of the, you know, the general fund of the
perhaps
county itself.
I know, Mike, Ed, is this one you looked at, Mike, as treasurer? You didn't look at this one.
I'm just reading it here, and it's referring to a previous resolution. Perhaps the source of funding is located in the previous resolution. It says it was awarded an additional grant for improvements, and it talks about the local match and the same sharing proportion. So perhaps there's something in a previous resolution that we're not aware of. This one seems to be, it says, requesting Resolution 531 of 2013 be amended to include additional grant funding. And then the resolve is amended to include additional grant funding. So I'm thinking that probably in the initial resolution, maybe the source of funding was mentioned. That was how I read it.
Yeah, I think this is a state grant.
Most of those that were grant fund were coming from the O&M operation, from either the parking or the funds from events there. I wasn't involved with the first one, and I can't answer the second one.
We'll have the clerk pull it. Information before we vote. Anybody else has any comments on resolutions? Yes, Supervisor.
Do we have a roll call on 199? Is that Supervisor Strauss resolution?
199?
Yeah.
Sure. I'll let Amanda know. Any other comments or roll calls on resolutions? Supervisor Leggett?
There is something on Resolution 195, I'd like to make some
hand
out to
the website. Absolutely. Sure. You can, if you want to talk, bring it down. We're talking about resolutions, so.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
While he's discussing that, can I also add 188? I had to make the change, the decrease of the salary from 68,973 to 66,000.
That's
just amend that. Amend that resolution.
What resolution was
that? 188.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Matt. The salary. What's the salary? Have a second by Mr. Thomas. All those in favor to amend resolution 188, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Now, Mr. Leggett is handing out information on resolution 195.
In the Legislative and Rules Committee meeting, I gave a presentation pointing out some of the flaws in the premise that Warren County is unconstitutional and with its board of supervisors. And what you're looking at here is a pie chart that's divided up with the weighted vote. The large block you see is the weighted vote for all of Queensburg. Everyone else has a very distinct piece of pie. But Queensbury shares their weighted vote together because each one of the supervisors at large represents the whole town. Following up on what Ms. Bieber had said, we pointed out that this is where the problem lies. It is not necessarily in the structure of the board of supervisors of Warren County. It is how the supervisors from the town of Queensbury represent the residents in the town of Queensbury.
They are not tied to any specific number of people. So for that, I do not see here a reason to change the governance structure of the Warren County Board of Supervisors. But listening to Ms. Deesburg, I do think we should be able to support Queensbury and whatever action would be needed by Warren County to help on the reorganization on how Queensbury residents are represented here on the board. I would also like to call for a roll call vote on Resolution 195.
Any other discussion on resolutions? Supervisor Merlino?
Jeff, he went out. He just reminded me, and now that resolution that we're talking about was the funding was going to come out of OCTACs. Came out of the OCTACs committee to fund that match and will be reimbursed when the mayor gets back the funding from the state. It was an OCTACs thing.
Unfortunately, that's not Resolution 531 of 2013, sir.
What does that say? I mean, this is a different resolution, so I wasn't there then, so you're going to have to, what does it say?
Amanda brought this in. It says, resolve the source of funding for the county, 62% share of the grant related expenses shall be the general fund unappropriated surplus. That was back in 2013.
Yeah.
And it's, yeah. So back in 2013, is this an increase to that? Is that what you're doing?
I'll be honest with you, I can't answer that question. It was done.
This total was like $2,500,000 back in 2013.
Then this can't be the same one.
And whereas the Village of Lake George was awarded a grant from the New York State Department of State, the amount of $750 for improvements to the Lake George Environmental Park, whereas the Village was awarded a grant from the Wright Foundation, well, this goes in to say where they got all the money from, whereas Warren County is 62% owner. It will own 62% of all improvements. So, you want to, I mean, what's the pleasure of the board?
I think you should pull it, and I'll get the information.
On the table, or just pull it?
Yeah.
Yes, Supervisor.
Those DOS grants, Department of State grants, are administered by individual communities, not necessarily the one who's benefiting from it. And I think that may be part of this situation, right, Ron?
I think the best thing to do is if it's not going to harm the municipal, I've suggested to do it.
Let's find out more about it.
I don't have the details of
just pull it to next meeting?
Yeah.
If that doesn't harm one.
Just withdraw it to next meeting, or do you want table? Withdraw or table?
We'll table it for now and bring it back at the next meeting. I'll get Frank his
information. Do we have a second to table? Second? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. The table 169. And yes.
Resolution 195.
Yes.
I assume that they're simply asking us to reconsider where we are and explore some alternatives.
This resolution was a request by Supervisor Wood. I believe it will be an up or down vote, a yes vote.
I wanted an up or down vote. That's not quite what this resolution says. This resolution has to do with establishing a committee to further explore, but I believe it could be viewed as an up or down vote. Essentially, if you want to continue to look into legislature, vote yes, and if you don't, vote no. And that should simplify the process a bit.
Any other, we'll get to public. Supervisor Strauss.
Well, again, on Resolution 195, and, you know, I've researched this topic, and I've come across legislative forms of county government that aren't so pretty. I mean, legislators, Nassau, they increased their own pay from $39,500 to $75,000. They've become full-time. And the legislators don't necessarily represent any particular community. And many of the legislators even have their own offices with aides. I mean, it's become a full-time job. I'm not seeing where a legislative form of government would be beneficial to the county of Warren. But if you take a look at the great debate that our founders had back in 1789, was the topic of equal protection. You had the big states, little states. The big states were advocating one house where each state, based on its population, would get representation based on the population. The larger the state population, the more voters they would have in that house. The small states said, listen, the big states are going to outvote us every time, and we have some interests, and how are we ever going to have our little voices known? How are we going to have a vote? So they came up with the Great Compromise. And the Great Compromise was to form two houses. The House of Representatives, where your big states got your most number of representatives and the most voice. And you had a Senate, where every state gets two representatives and got equal voice. And any bill or legislation that went through had to be passed by both houses and signed by a president. So there was the checks and balances. Well, no charter government in New York State that I know of is a bicameral situation. We're all single houses. So, as we are here, so Thurman, Warrensburg, Hague, Chester, Horicon, so forth, these have their town supervisors representing their town here in this body, this single house. And I can think of no other better representative to represent that community, Chester, Hague, Warrensburg, than that town supervisor. So their voices do not get drowned out in the majority. They get recognized. They get heard. So you know what? It works. It works for Warren County. Now, we have weighted votes. So you're talking about equal protection. So Queensberry gets 425 votes out of 1,000. That's pretty significant. Well, then the question comes up of what about committees? Well, in committees, everybody's voice should be heard. But if there is something that didn't come out of a committee, any supervisor here can bring it up to this floor, just as I did tonight in 199. Not that any committee suppressed it, they did. It's just the time factor. I had to bring it up now if I want it to be effective for July. But what is broken with the system that we have? I'm not seeing anything broken.
Okay, Supervisor Seaver and then Supervisor Brenner.
Supervisor Leggett, I appreciate the chart and the support, certainly. I'm not convinced, however, that you're looking at your representative from Queensberry who agree with that idea, that, say, a ward representation would be better than an at-large representation. We did have a meeting last Monday. While it wasn't well attended for various reasons, we heard from Supervisor Montesi and Supervisor Stroud that they prefer at-large. I know, in speaking with Supervisor Beatty, he supports the ward or, you know, is open to those discussions, and I think those discussions are continuing. So if this is just the Queensberry and we don't have a problem, I'm not convinced the support is there by Queensberry to fix it, if it needs to be fixed. And I think it's important that we go to our community and we spend a little more time and not rush through a decision to change our representation without more involvement from the community. And this has all come up in the context of, do we extend our terms of office and put that on the ballot for the public to consider? Do we talk about term limits? Do we talk about just kind of how Kingsbury functions altogether? One of the very positive things that have come out from discussions with the DCs is that we are meeting collectively in the future, the council and the at-large representation. So I think that there's a lot of positive from having discussions, but because I'm not in a position to say, I would love for the Board of Supervisors to pass this resolution that would change the way that we represent Kingsbury at this point in time, and frankly, I don't think that's the right thing to do without getting more input from the community. So I appreciate it. I think it's a good point, but I do think there's going to be a lot more discussion about it. For that reason, I'm going to support 195 just to continue to talk about alternative forms of government, because if this, in your opinion, is the problem, and if it doesn't get fixed, then we're still looking at an issue with our representation here in Kingsbury. So, you know, some people said, well, the town issue, deal with it at the town. But that's the problem. It's not a town issue. By the way, it was created here at the board. So I think that has been one of the suggestions from the council, is to come to the board and say, you know, and our county attorney and I have been having some discussions about it, turn over that jurisdiction to Kingsbury and let Kingsbury decide what's best for Kingsbury, instead of having to come to the entire board and ask for that resolution. Or they might decide they like it the way it is. So I don't have an answer to that, but I do know that having these discussions have been incredibly helpful, and I appreciate everyone's time and being so open to be discussing that type of alternative government. So I really appreciate that.
Supervisor Brammer?
I'll just echo that a little bit, that I think it's important to leave the discussion open and to reflect on how we can improve. Maybe there's not gigantic problems, but I think that there's ways that we could improve. And I don't think we necessarily need to go to an entirely different alternative form of government, but there might be some tweaks that we can do, especially now that I heard today, I didn't know that before, that Queensbury is set up through the county. So we can't just turn it over to the town and say, fix it. They can't. But I'm going to support 195.
Supervisor Brock?
Yes, I basically agree with John Strau about the, if you look at democracy, the majority can rule, but it also can crowd out the minority. And the compromise that he's talking about was where the Senate represents the minority, in effect, the small town or the small states, and it balances out the majority. And with the weighted vote, it's not possible for, say, Queensbury, I mean, under the legislative form, if Queensbury, and I sort of did a straight line, quick look at the population, Queensbury in 25, 30 years could have the absolute majority of population, in which case, under a purely legislative form, it could dominate the whole thing, and we might as well not show up except for the Queensbury legislators. So this, what we have right now, I think, is a better approach. But I think it's really none of my business what Queensbury does. But the one thing I looked at was, when you look at equal representation, the problem is that when you have a very large district, the minorities within that district have a harder time getting their representation, because the large majority will override their vote. When you break it down into smaller groups, that gives that minority a larger say, particularly if they're located in one district. It gives them more of a chance of having a say than if it's like Queensbury is one large group. It's mostly, it's, I don't know, what is it? It's more Republican than Democrat. So if they broke it down, it would give certain groups a better chance at equal representation. When I also looked at the county, and I looked at what Mark Westcott had done, and he said one-third of the county is Democrat. If you look at here, even based on way to vote, one-third of the county here is Democrat. So the system, however you want to look at it, actually it has equal representation. There's one-third Democrat. It represents the small groups. It has a way of balancing out the simple majority. And I had talked to Brian about the committee system. If you don't like something that's been done in the committee, you can bring it back here. We really make the committees don't make the decisions. We make the final decision. You can bring it back here the way John did, and you can override whatever a committee said. But I think the one thing I'm afraid of is if we vote no, then there are going to be people who say, well, this is just another example of the establishment crowding out or suppressing a different point of view, and I think it's more important to have an open discussion so that our, whatever your view is, wins on its merits and doesn't win on a vote.
Thank you. Supervisor Leggett.
So thank you, Ms. Siever. For the same reason you are going to vote yes, I'm going to vote no for this. Your actions and the supervisors at Queensbury is the correct approach. And the way that this resolution is worded, it says to change the existing form of county government to an alternate form of government. And I cannot support that. What I can support is a mutual agreement right here on how the town of Queensbury and the rest of the towns within the county can come together and work on it. It was brought out by a former supervisor at large from Queensbury that this was unfair and unconstitutional. And I have made the case the best I could that that is not true. So there is, if Queensbury is comfortable in its form and how it's represented here at the board, I'll speak for myself that I go along with you, but I do not see a need to change the form of government.
Thank you. We had, yes, go ahead.
Thank you.
Supervisor.
Yeah, and I read the resolution the same way Supervisor Leggett did, not the way Supervisor Wood did. So first, I would like clarification on that. Second of all, I was not able to make the Monday meeting. I had spoken to Supervisor Siever, and we had a great conversation. At first blush, I'm with Supervisor Strau, Steve Aquino. If it's not broken, don't fix it. I do feel that conversation is healthy, though. I had brought up the fact of terms. My first 2 years on here, I had a tough time just figuring out acronyms. So we saw what happened with Westmount. Nothing got accomplished for three and three quarters of a year. Also, I have questions on how the weighted vote will work. What kind of authority and weighted vote will the town supervisor get? So I am going to vote yes, but like I said, at first blush, I'm happy with the way the system is currently.
Okay. Supervisor Montessi.
The town of Queensbury is a unique situation that exists. There's four wards. One ward has almost 10,000 people. The other three wards has about 3,500. We've spent, John and I have spent the last 2 years working on trying to balance that. We've come up with a new ward system, gotten the approval of the new town board. So it's something that we would like to see happen. That, and along with that, some of the rhetoric that has come out is perhaps if you're going to do the new wards, maybe instead of being supervisors at large, you would be supervisors, county supervisors for a ward. Well, that's probably worth discussing some more, but it's an entirely different, you know, set of circumstances than this resolution. I don't mind having that discussion, and I don't mind having a discussion about term limits. That's a Queensbury situation, and I think if we had that discussion, then we would come back to this board and say, can you release us? Can you give us the authority to make those decisions? So I'm going to vote no on this resolution because I don't think the form of government that we have is wrong, but I guess it's voting no.
Okay. Supervisor Dixon.
Agreeing with John Strau.
Well, can I get clarification on the resolution? How was it read?
Thank you. I drafted the resolution based on the minutes and the video from the committee meeting, and there was some confusion about whether it was going to be amended. In the end, it was not amended. My drafting reflected, in part, a term that's set forth in the county law, alternative form of county government, and that means something besides a board of supervisors, some type of a county legislature that would be established by a county charter. My understanding of the minutes and of the video was that the question to be asked by an up or down vote was whether this body wants to continue to explore changing from a board of supervisors to a county legislature of some kind or another, not having to do with the way that representatives from Queensbury are chosen within a board of supervisors. That, to me, is a different question. That's the way I drafted this resolution, if that helps.
Supervisor Dickerson.
We got like six conversations going on here. The resolution, as explained, I'm not in favor of. I want to vote down. I'm happy with where we are. What I'm not necessarily unhappy with, but concerned about mathematically, is that if you look at this pie chart, Queensbury, shown as the town of Queensbury, the whole county, is 42% of the voting plus, of the voting, weighted voting. What they haven't shown is they delineated each of the five wards in Glens Falls. If you put them together, they would constitute 22%. Now, theoretically, mathematically, Queensbury and one of the larger wards in Glens Falls can do anything they want at this county board. They have enough weighted votes. Queensbury and one or two other towns would have majority vote. The issue we have here, and I'm not sure it's a problem for us, I'd be interested in seeing what Queensbury wants to do with this. I think the idea to go to more equally balanced wards is a good idea. I think it's a better idea if northern Queensbury is represented in southern Queensbury. Northern Queensbury, of course, is along the lake. Southern Queensbury is full of box stores and used car dealerships. They're two different entities. My concern here is I'm not interested in the resolution. I am interested in what Queensbury wants to do. I would very much like to keep the county in conversation with Queensbury and where they're going, because I have these other issues that I am concerned about. Thank you.
Supervisor Strahl and then Supervisor Siever.
The way I see it, this resolution is asking us about the county government as it is now. And after hours of research and hours of discussion, I think it's working fine, the structure of the county government like it is. The other discussion, whether the Queensbury at-large supervisors would want to go to ward supervisors, would want to go to 2 to 4 years, would want to have term limits, that's here. That's not Resolution 195. That's a separate discussion, and I'm willing to have that discussion. But that's not the discussion here.
Supervisor Siever?
And again, I brought up that discussion in response to Mr. Leggett's chart, where he said the problem was within Queensbury. So I appreciate the support from the entire board in this discussion, and you know, recognize that you know we need to take a look at this as an entity and determine whether or not there's a problem. But that's not the discussion on the resolution that's before us today. But again, healthy discussion. What I keep hearing is that collectively as elected officials, I'm hearing, I think this is best. I don't think that the system is broke. I think it works well. In that conversation in committee, there was a suggestion about a citizen's representation and putting together a committee that could take a look that included the public, our voters, the people that elect us. And I think that's worth considering. And again, you know, that's exactly why I'm going to support this resolution, although it doesn't really sound like it's going to pass. But I thank you for all of the feedback, because this is what we need with Queensbury.
Supervisor McDonald, did you have your hand up?
Well, I did. We are having quite a few conversations here. Obviously, there's the interpretation, and you articulated what your intent was with the drafting of the resolution. But there are elements of this conversation that I don't want to go away because this resolution is voted down. We talked about Queensbury and the wards or having the at-large, but there's also the conversation with the mayor at the county board. And something that I want to discuss is where exactly does that process end with the city charter and begin with the county? And I think that conversation needs to be had as well. And
if voting this down ends that conversation, then I'm not sure I'm very happy with that. So I think, I guess I'm going to support this resolution only because I want to make sure that conversation is being had.
Okay. Supervisor Brock, and then Supervisor Wood, and I think we need to open up the public comment.
Yeah, my concern right now is that there's two different votes going on with the resolution. One has to do with whether we want to change the county government, which I don't want to do. The other is, do we want to continue to have a discussion on this? And I think we do want to do that. I think even Supervisor Stroud would like to continue it just for the sake of educating the public or whatever. So no matter what the vote is, can we continue? Would you be willing to continue the discussion as long as it doesn't take up, you know, half your life or whatever?
Well, you're asking me a question?
Yes, yes. I guess that.
Well, my opinion is I only have so much time.
That's why I
have a lot of very significant issues before me at the town level and even at the county level. I'm sure this conversation will go on, and if it gains enough momentum, we can bring it back.
Right.
I'm opposed to formally recognizing a further discussion of this because I'm looking at this as the county government, and I've been here for over 2 years, and I've been with town government for 14 years, and I think from what I see, it works for Warren County. End of discussion.
Okay, we have two more, and then we're going to open up to the public. Mr. Thomas and Ms. Wood.
Thank you.
Cut it off, but
thank you, Mr. Chairman. My concern is that the people in the small town of Stony Creek have a voice here at this board, and I feel if we change the form of government to a legislative board, they're going to lose a lot of their voice. Whether you think I'm a good representative or a bad one, that's everybody's opinion. That's fine. And I'm sure people in Stony Creek have that same opinion. But that's my concern, are those folks. What Queensbury does, what Glens Falls, if you want the mayor on the board, those are your issues. I'll help, you know, support you through this board to accomplish that. But, you know, I'm concerned about the people in Stony Creek.
Well, just briefly, I want to point out, if we vote to take this and go and do further exploration to the county, we are subsequently delaying the conversations at Queensbury and Glens Falls pending a decision on what we're going to do with our county government. Because we move to a legislature, discussions about ward systems or having the mayor on the board, well, they're essentially pointless because if they have all that going on, they spend all this time investigating it, we turn around and go to a legislative system, that conversation is moot at that point. So I really think that Glens Falls and Queensbury, if they want to do these explorations, need some direction from this board that we're going to maintain a board of supervisors so that they can move forward with their own deliberations.
Okay, now let's open it up to the public.
Travis Whitehead, Queensbury. Thank you for bringing this up. But actually, when I look at this, I see the same thing, but I see it differently. And what I see is that Queensbury has half the population, nearing half the population, and yet there are only 5 voices here today and 15 voices on the other side. And while it is weighted today, but today is the only day, one day out of 30, that these voices will carry any weight. I would agree with a lot of things that are said here, and in fact, I would agree that there is no local law, no county law, no state law that would say what you're doing now is wrong in any fashion and could not continue indefinitely. But in the early 1990s, these same discussions were going on in Nassau County, and they were going nowhere as well. So somebody filed a federal lawsuit, and in 1994, that judge went ahead and said, this particular makeup of the Nassau County Board of Supervisors does not square with the 14th Amendment equal protection. And they then went ahead and looked at the alternatives and went to a form of legislative government. Now, I'm not telling you that the 14th Amendment says that a Board of Supervisors is illegal in every case. It isn't. It's saying you could still do that here, for instance, but in order to do that, if you have a voice that represents 2% of the people here, like these two people at the end, and you would need 50 voices like that, 50 at 2%. You would need 50 people in this room. You'd need over 20 people just from Queensbury elected and sitting here to have equal voices. Now, it's probably an unworkable alternative, and I'm pretty sure you guys would throw that out in a hurry. So you'd have to consider something else and something else. So all I'm saying is that I'm glad you're having this discussion, but I don't think it's going to be ended today, in any event. I hope you continue to discuss it, and I agree, completely with what Ron and John said about, the discussion of how Queensbury internally handles the wards and everything is a separate discussion for a separate day. That's true as well. And that can continue unabated from what might happen here. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Supervisor Beatty, you had...
Yeah, thank you. I'm just going to weigh in on a couple things. Number one is we worry about Queensbury becoming too powerful. I think that's part of the thing. About 5 or 10 years, we could have the majority population. We'd have the majority weighted vote. So you want to be concerned, about that. If you feel you don't have a voice now...
You wouldn't.
Well, let me finish. We're weighted on population, correct?
No.
We're 42.5% of the population.
No, that's incorrect.
Well, okay. And second thing is, a legislative form of government would erase that. Obviously, you'd have legislators throughout the county, and they'd represent a certain amount of population throughout the county. So, to me, that's almost a fairer way, and it protects the smaller communities more than the current format.
Thank you. Mr. Stroud, you have the last word.
Okay, thank you. First of all, we're not the other side. You're not the other side. You're not the other side. We're here to work together on county issues. We're here to share ideas. We're here to represent our town's interests. We're here for the county. There's no sides to this. All right. I wanted to make that point, and there shouldn't be. We're here to work together. The other thing is Nassau County. Here's an article I downloaded. I've done my research. Nassau County, they voted themselves, this is December 21st, 2015, out of Newsday magazine. Nassau legislators increased their own pay from $39,500 to $75,000. Now, there's 19 legislators. They each have their own office. Each office has a beautiful flat-screen TV, and they each have two aides. And you know what the costs are associated with that? All right, so I don't know if I'd use Nassau County as a prime example of why we should work towards a legislative form of government. So I just wanted to make that point, and that is my final point.
Jim, I'll let you go.
Well, I just...
You've been good. Go ahead.
If you look up... And Brian can back me on this. If you look at the weighted vote, the state doesn't allow any one group under the weighted vote to dominate. So at some point, I don't know if there's some fancy mathematical term, I don't know what, but it doesn't allow, if Queensbury had 51% of the population under the weighted vote, under this particular system, it couldn't have 51% of the weighted vote.
Who would have them, 50?
I don't know. There's a form.
Okay.
There's a formula that goes with it.
All right, let's move on. I appreciate all the good conversation. Let's move on with our vote on resolutions. Yes.
If you're on our side,
Mr. Durer. Well, I was going to bring it up at the end of the meeting, but the more I listen to this, which isn't going to happen in my lifetime, all this changing, but the discussion. I love discussion. God knows I love discussion, but this is, I'm here to represent the city as with the other four other colleagues, and I have a perplexing thing that happened, and I would like some help from the county. Anytime the cities come to the county, generally outside of the police consolidation where we've had some issues there, the county has generally come forward and looked at the logic and helped, and they've been a great resource
since I've been on this board for 10 years. Here's the issue that I have. The city wanted to do a solar project. Okay, they wanted to do it on land in Queensbury. And I was on a school board for 15 years, so I understand all the parameters and the difficulties of preparing a budget. And they opted not to give us the tax break, which would cost us some $150,000, is what I see in the paper. So viably, that project is not going to happen. They're not going to do it. They can't afford it. It doesn't work. The numbers don't work. So my point is, by that school board doing that, it deprived the citizens of a huge benefit. I mean, when I was on the council from 1994, we spent over $500,000 just on street lighting, et cetera. So certainly, you know, solar and what's going on and sweeping across the country with windmills, et cetera, this is something that we're supposed to do. And when I read it, I'm personally saying this, that I see what goes on in government, and I see the negotiations that go on to extend a sewer agreement up Main Street so that two new hotels can be built in Queensbury that the school board is going to reap a harvest off of. Okay, that's because Glens Falls negotiated. It's good. It's good for the area. We go to the Adirondack Gateway Council, which Ed Bartholomew's had, and we're trying regionally with South Glens Falls and Moreau and Hudson Falls and Fort Edward, and collectively we submitted and got grants to see our whole area grow. And this little pinpoint of a perspective where the city wants to do solar to help out our taxpayers. And we know what we're up against. Property tax, is that the fairest? If the city of Glens Falls is 3 square miles and Queensbury is 32 square miles and you're deriving your revenue on property tax, who you think wins that battle? If you have a hospital that's off the tax rolls, if you have museums and churches, it was said at one time when I was on, it was like 27% of the property taxable entities were off. We couldn't tax them because they're nonprofits. So here we are looking to take a piece of property and put solar on it to benefit our taxpayers, okay, to pay for street lighting and all those things. It looks like a great thing, and I understand respectfully for the people that sit on board at Queensbury School that they need every dime they get. I understand that. But I'm respectfully asking today if we could get a resolution asking them to reconsider, because the project is not going to happen because of that amount of money and the taxation. If it isn't going to happen, they virtually have killed the benefit that our taxpayers sincerely need. And I think you people have always been good about recognizing the needs of our county citizens.
I'll second that resolution.
Thank you, sir. I think we got to bring it off the floor or whatever. I'm just asking for a reconsideration of the school board to look at it again. That's all from the – and if it came from this body, I think that's prevalent.
We're on a spur track now. You want to bring a resolution about solar in the city of Glens Falls?
I want to bring a resolution that says we're asking the Queensbury School Board to reconsider their taxation position on the solar farm that the city of Glens Falls wants to do in the town of Queensbury.
Right. Is that a county?
It was seconded.
Well, we can't. We have to waive it. Somebody want to make a motion to waive the rules?
I'll make a motion to waive the rules.
Ron Montesi and Dennis Dixon waive the rules. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Now, we have a motion by Mr. Girard, seconded by Mr. Strau, to send a letter to the Queensbury School Board opposing their...
asking them to reconsider. I respect their vote. I'm just asking them to reconsider because the people here understand, I guess, what I'm saying.
What are they reconsidering?
Reconsider their position on taxing the solar farm.
Yeah, the solar farm receives an automatic 487 tax exemption for 15 years, unless there's an objectionable party. In this case, it was the school.
Okay.
And what we're asking, because, and I would have liked to have been at that school board meeting myself to advocate for the city, but I had another meeting that night.
As Dan said, it's $150,000 that the school board said, no, we're not going to give that exemption.
Okay. Now, Dennis has had his hand up, and I'm surprised he's kept it up this long, but let me go to Dennis.
I thought you were testing me.
I wasn't.
No.
I want to be fair.
There are two issues here. We've had some issues with our school board over taxation, and they can be frustrating, and I appreciate where you're coming from. The second issue is that Lake George has done a solar project. Our solar farm for our solar project in Lake George is in Argyle. And we are on that with two other partners. One of them is Edna, and the other one is Warren Tire. We have a little acreage in Argyle, and they're going to put our solar panels over there. That's a suggestion if you're not successful with our resolution. I'm fully in support of...
Do you pay school tax? Did the school board object and opt out of the tax benefit?
The school board in Argyle? Not that I know of.
No, in this case, and I know solar, right?
You know solar.
All right. The city, most financially advantageous position for solar is for them to provide their own piece. So they have a 30-some-odd acre spot, 20 acres of which would be used for this 5-point-something megawatt solar system that would be the city's property and to the benefit of the city. Yes, you can do an off-site, what they call off-site, in this case it's city-owned. You can do an off-site one, but your financial advantages are not as strong. You can do what Dennis did, but the city makes more using its own property. So it's got 20-some-odd acres that it's going to use for the solar farm, and it's the city-owned property. Where else in the town of Queensbury are you going to get 20 acres? I mean, the school is worried about setting a precedent. But where else are you going to get 20 acres that somebody's going to say, well, let's use this for a solar farm instead of putting 20 houses there in Queensbury? Okay? In other words, if they're worried about setting a precedent, I think that worry is unfounded. But that's the reason why they want to use their own property. They will make more money.
Supervisor Cheever.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm pleased to see all of the support for all of these out-of-committee resolutions and discussions off the floor. When I initially came on the board, that was really frowned upon. So, you know, maybe we have made a lot of headway with these legislative discussions because we're hearing a lot of this month. But that being said, I think that we're going down a slippery slope here. The school board isn't here to talk on their behalf. We aren't hearing another side of this. If we want to have this discussion and engage the school board without, I think it's a leap, and I think that it's a little... we could start then writing to all different boards and asking them to reconsider things that I just, could we maybe invite them to a committee meeting and hear from them and do this maybe in a little more fact-finding and curious?
Well, I mean, a resolution asking them to change their minds isn't...
I'm not asking them to change their mind. I'm just asking them to reconsider.
We're asking them to reconsider. Maybe we could do that, and then maybe that would set them up to set up a meeting with us in the future.
I'm very uncomfortable with that.
Okay. I understand. And I just got to say that, you know, we, all the other communities that it doesn't involve have been sitting here very patiently listening. Right? And I think they're going to offer support. Supervisor Leggett.
Mr. Chairman, is the town of Queensbury going to get $150,000 off that one call plan if there is nothing else on
that? Oh, I'm deferred to Supervisor Schell.
No, no. The city owns it. And it's owned.
Part of the watershed.
Yeah, as far, you know, it's a little section that they don't need. The city owns it. And it's owned, so it can't be used for really anything else financially. The best use for that is for the city to use it for a solar farm. And it's not going to cost the town anything other than we could make the objectionable claim for taxes, but that's not a big deal. But I don't think we should. Solar is good. Solar is good for the environment. Solar is good for upgrading the grid system. Solar is good for... upgrading the security. Solar is the thing that, with global warming, we should be working on alternative energy. So the city wants to do the right thing and make money for its residents. It's a win-win.
Okay, thank you. Now, we have one public comment because we did, we have one public comment before we vote.
Thank you, Travis Whitehead, Queensbury. A few things I wanted to point out. We're talking about $150,000 exemption that would be granted to Solar City, a private company, not to Glens Falls. This is a private company. And that's for like a 2-megawatt system that they're thinking of putting in there. We have other taxpayers in the town that pay a lot of money in school taxes. I know I pay taxes. My neighbors pay taxes. If I knew my neighbors weren't paying as much as I or getting special treatment, I'd be down there yelling. Well, we have a situation with the Sherman Island Dam, Brookfield Power, far larger operation, far more taxes than we're talking about with the $150,000 exemption here. And if the school board were to go ahead and grant this to green energy, solar is good, except if you look at the economics. But solar is good, it's green, so is hydroelectric. It can't be any better than hydroelectric. If we were to grant this, I think, you know, Brookfield Power has already questioned their assessments in the past. They will undoubtedly do it in the future. I think it's the reason why other communities have opted out, like Hudson Falls and such, because they have these hydro producers, and they are going to get complaints. And that's one of the reasons, I think, that we're that the school district looked at this. So, you know, ask them for their opinion. I think it could be ask them to address you. You know, maybe they would like to. I have no problem with any of that. But I also like to mention that when I did my research on this, and I might be wrong, but I'm pretty darn sure that I saw Argyle on that list. So you may want to check of communities that have opted out of this. Just a FYI, you may want to check that. Or if you want to email me, I'll send you what it is I had. But, you know, I just want to let you know. Okay?
Thank you.
Now we have a motion, and we have a second to bring it from the floor. All those in favor of bringing a resolution from the floor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. One opposed. Two opposed. Okay. Now let's vote on resolutions.
Mr. Chen.
What?
Mr. Murray. Please, before you vote on the other, you're talking not that one, the other, all the others, I would like to have Jeff Tennyson, superintendent, give us an answer to the question that Frank had, because he's the one that brought it up, and he will explain to you and Frank what, and so I'd like to, I might want to read back, put it back on the agenda.
Supervisor Bramer?
Didn't we table that?
It's been tabled.
But I can bring it back up again, but I'd like our superintendent of the highways that's involved
in it. DPW superintendent, we would love to address the board, have him step to the podium, state his name and location for the record.
Okay, thanks. I wasn't here for the question, but I understand it was about the funding sources. The resolution request that was number, or the resolution was 169, was to amend a intermunicipal agreement with the Village of Lake George. That intermunicipal agreement was all about cash flow for the village. And at the time in 2013 when that resolution was passed, there was a list of projects and grant funds that the village had been awarded, totaling millions of dollars, in which they were all reimbursable grants, meaning the village had to upfront the money, do the project, and then get reimbursed from various agencies like New York State DOT for a TEP grant. And there were some DOS grants, and then there was a lot of Wood Foundation funding and other things involved with it. That resolution for the cash flow agreement was specific to those projects. Didn't list one of the more recent grants that the village was awarded, which was a $400,000 project to do the water feature and signage in the park. So the amendment was needed simply to allow the county to advance for cash flow purposes portions of the project so that the village didn't have to go out and bond money just for cash flow. And that's really what that resolution was all about. As far as the project funding, those of you that may have been at the tourism OCTAX, and at the time it included Wood Park committee meeting, it was the last full one where the Wood Park was part of the tourism and OCTAX. The mayor came and asked and addressed the committee and stated that they were short on local match for that project. The last EOS grant was a 50-50, and he stated he needed another $150,000 in local match, for which they did not have. All the other Wood Foundation funds and other private funding had been committed. And then at that committee meeting of tourism, OCTAX, Wood Park, the committee moved, and then the board moved last month to pull $150,000 out of the OCTAX reserve to fund that local match. So that was under a separate resolution. So I don't know if the concerns were over some of the language in amending that 2013 resolution regarding the project, but...
No, my concern is...
Source of funding.
$24,000 for a match that the county is asking for. Is that accounted for in this local match that you have set aside?
It's a village project. The mayor came and asked for additional $150,000 in local match, which the board moved on, I believe, last month, and that came out of OCTAC's reserve.
Now, was that to cover this?
Yes, it's the same grant. The resolution request, you know, or that resolution 169 is to amend the agreement. It's not to fund the project. It's not to otherwise move money around. It's to amend the agreement that allows the county, when the village gets a $100,000 bill, the county advances 62% of it based on our ownership. They pay the 38%. If they can't come up with their 38%, they have to bond money for cash flow purposes. And then eventually when the village is reimbursed their grant, the county funding comes back. That percentage comes back.
So this money has been accounted for out of action?
Yes. And again, this resolution was simply to amend the cash flow agreement that has been, you know, necessary for them. They've advanced, you know, probably $3 or $4 million worth of grant projects, and that was really about their bonding of cash flow that was the concern.
Well, we have an NSTEM project that we can't fund either, so, you know, this isn't taken care of here.
Frank, was that explanation understood? And they paid back from 2 years ago the money we funded them forward, right, Jeff? We got all the money back.
I think so. The DOT grant came back very quickly. The DOS grant, as we all know, come back slower. I don't know where we're at with the final reimbursement, but every time they get a reimbursement back from one of those granting agencies, they send a check back to the county for the county support to be funded for tax.
Supervisor Dickerson?
They had a meeting of the Lake George Watershed Coalition. This grant came up. It's being processed. They're really close, getting close to paying the county for that grant. It finally cleared all the hurdles.
Okay.
So what I'm wishing to do is put that back on the agenda so we can have the cash flow for...
Are you making a motion to untable?
I'd like to bring in, if I could get a second, yeah, I'd like to untable it.
We have a second?
Second.
Second by Supervisor Thomas. Who had the question? Do we have to vote on that? Mm-hmm. Yes, we have to vote.
Majority vote to remove
the
table.
It's a majority vote to remove it from the table, so we need a roll call. Hold on. We have a discussion before we vote.
Yes, please. I'm still not clear. I mean, Mr. Molino just said it's for cash funding purposes, but I thought my understanding was the funding was already out there. This was amending the language of the agreement. Are these dollars already out, or are we authorizing another $124,000?
We're authorizing another $124,000. This is because the way this is.
No, we're not.
We did that last month, right?
We did that already, right. This is just to come, this came out of the committee.
This is just to amend the agreement.
It's
accounting for the money that, part of the money that we spent last month, the way I understand.
I think, we're going to front the money and then we'll get paid back.
Right.
Is that correct, Jeff? We're going to front.
The problem was the resolution that was done back in 2013.
Didn't count this one.
So what is it, simply adding that to the project list that allows the county, the treasurer will advance funds to the village, and then the treasurer will receive the money back when the village gets their grant reimbursement. The county is not part of the grant, but we're 62% owner in the project, and that's why we're advancing 62% of the cash flow.
One more discussion. Yes?
I just have, are we fronting them $124,000 or whatever it is? Is that what we're fronting?
Any of the other
But we're fronting them 62% of the...
Right, and so once the, as long as the OCTAC funds that hit the project, really what we're fronting is the grant reimbursable portion. And I think that's where the 124 was calculated at. That is the portion of the grant reimbursable portion of the project.
You know, in the future, I wish somebody would draw a picture. Seriously, draw us a picture of what we're talking about in the future,
well,
rather than wording, because it's too complicated.
It is, because the way this is written, you know,
we need to draw pictures showing the funds. Here's what we started with. Here's what we've been reimbursed. Here's what we're hoping, because I know the treasurer has a problem with advancing funds ahead of signed contracts and grant executions. I'm making my pitch for the treasurer. Go ahead.
The grant is a $400,000 grant.
What's that?
But it's a $400,000 project, of which 50% of it is reimbursed by DLS. The DLS is paying, is providing $200,000 in reimbursement for $400,000 in work. When the mayor came to that OCTAC tourism committee, he said, I don't have the full 200 local match. I need an additional 150 from somewhere, and that's when the committee moved to move 150 out of OCTAC reserve. The 124,000 cash advance is 62% of the grant amount of $200,000. So that is the portion that everything else is either local match or it's village 38% for the grant reimbursement. The 124,000 represents 62% of $200,000 in grant reimbursements that we're going to be waiting on up in the village for the DLS to reimburse. So that is the portion that we're paying on.
That is clear as mud. Okay. Any other discussion? I guess we don't need a roll call vote on this. We just need a voice vote to untable. We have a motion. We have a second. All those in favor of untabling, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed.
Opposed.
How much? Show raise your hand so I know. Okay, 3, 4, 5. It passes.
Is that by weighted vote or is that by simple majority?
The majority of weighted votes.
So it is weighted vote.
Yes.
What, did we add them up?
I did in my head.
Wow,
quick.
You're pretty good, Kevin. That was about a half a second.
Well, equal 250, but go ahead. You want to just add them up? Sure, go ahead. We'll do it. It's not a problem. Go for 250. I'll buy you a cup of coffee.
Cream and sugar, please.
All right. This is a motion to bring Resolution 169 back to the floor. Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
No.
Mr. Brock?
No.
Mr. McDonald?
No.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslo?
No.
Mr. Dickinson?
This is unbelievable.
Yeah.
Just say yes.
Is that a yes or no?
I say yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Strau?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
No.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
No.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Gary?
Yes. How many no's?
2-1.
Two what? Well, was that not close? Okay, so it passes, so we're going to vote. We'll put it back in the thing. Yes, Ms.
May I have a point of clarification regarding Supervisor Gerard's proposed resolution for the school board? I believe I voted yes to waive the rules to add it on. I'm all for waiving the rules again, loving this process.
Yes, you did.
But we didn't vote on that.
We haven't voted on,
no.
We voted on waiving rules, but
okay.
We haven't voted on the resolution.
So will that be assigned a separate number? How will that work?
It'll be, well, resolution, the waiving the rules resolution is going
to
be
number... No, he wants to know the resolution of his to...
201.
201. So you want to voice that one on 201?
Yes, please, roll call.
Okay.
Thank
you. That's fair. Is everybody happy now?
As soon as we get done, I'll be ecstatic.
I feel like Carnage, though.
Roll
maybe when we get to the top, we need to restate what we're voting on. You know, just to check. Okay?
Okay. I'll do my best.
Okay.
All right. Resolution 156, making supplemental appropriations. Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
Yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Stroud?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
Yes.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
Yes.
Resolution 157, amending Warren County budget for 2016. Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
Yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Stroud?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
Yes.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
Yes.
Resolution 177. Authorizing Town of Warrensburg to construct a water well for the town's municipal water system on Warren County property within the town. Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
Yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Stroud?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
Yes.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Garrett? Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
I abstain.
Resolution 187, approving settlement in the matter of Nicole Russo versus Warren County and authorizing transfer of funds. Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
Yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Stroud?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
Yes.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
Yes.
Resolution 188, amending table of organization. This was amended.
And this was amended by Supervisor Sokol.
Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
Yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Stroud?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
Yes.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
Yes.
Resolution 193, altering the standing rules of the board to change the time and date of the June 2016 board meeting. Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
No.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
Yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Stroud?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
Yes.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
Yes.
Resolution 195, exploring alternate forms of county government. Mr. McDevitt?
No.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
No.
Mr. Simpson?
No.
Mr. Vanslow?
No.
Mr. Dickinson?
No.
Mr. Merlino?
No.
Mr. Stroud?
No.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
Yes.
Mr. Montesi?
No.
Mr. Sokol?
No.
Mr. Thomas?
No.
Ms. Wood?
No.
Mr. Conover?
No.
Mr. Leggett?
No.
Mr. Gerard?
No.
Chairman Garrity?
No.
Okay. And Resolution 199, this is introducing Local Law Number 3 of 2016, was introduced by Mr. Stroud. Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
No.
Mr. Merlino?
No.
Mr. Stroud?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
I'm so sorry. What one are we on?
This is the local law number three that Mr. Strau introduced.
That's the local vendor.
Oh, gotcha. Thank you.
Mr. Beatty?
Yes.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes, firewood.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
Yes.
Passes. And then resolution 201, this is the request from Mr. asking the town of Queensbury School Board to reconsider their position on taxing the solar district for the city of Glens Falls. Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
Yes.
Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
Yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Strau?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
No.
Mr. Beatty?
Definitely no.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
Yes. Okay. Reflective on all those pair. Signify by saying that. Whoop.
I'm sorry. Were we going to have a roll call on 169? Or did that already? I thought that was bringing it back.
We didn't request. Is it too late to request? Is member too late? Do you want to?
You can do it. We can do one.
Do you want a roll call?
Yes.
What is it?
We have a request for a roll call on 169 on the payment of the wood bark. We can do it real quick.
Yep.
No problem.
You ready? Mr. McDevitt?
Yes.
Ms. Bramer?
No.
Mr. Brock?
No.
Mr. McDonald?
I didn't like the delivery on it prior, but yes.
Mrs. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Simpson?
Yes.
Mr. Vanslow?
Yes.
Mr. Dickinson?
Yes.
Mr. Merlino?
Yes.
Mr. Strau?
Yes.
Ms. Sieber?
Yes.
Mr. Beatty?
No.
Mr. Montesi?
Yes.
Mr. Sokol?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Wood?
Yes.
Mr. Conover?
Yes.
Mr. Leggett?
Yes.
Mr. Gerard?
Yes.
Chairman Garrity?
Yes.
Okay.
All right. Reflective on all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed to any of the other resolutions? Thank you. Pat. Announcements. Supervisor Beatty.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I handed out a baskets for Ben. It's everybody know Ben Osborne was killed in Afghanistan in 2010. And his father has done some amazing things in gathering funds. He supports 32 schools. He buys books. He buys clothes. It's just amazing what this man, his father, has done in the name of his son. He's probably one of the most unsung heroes in this county, Mr. Osborne. And all I'm saying is, please take a look at that. I know we have a lot of great causes in this county, but when someone does this for their son, and it's all 100% give back to the schools, he's got books for Ben, which are different outlets where he gets free books, and any child could take out a book they want. It boggles the mind what this man does. And he does it all out of his garage. He collects the things and he delivers. So please just take a look at that. I know, again, we have a lot of great causes, but this is something very special. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Supervisor Brown.
Yeah, I just want to tell Supervisor Dickinson that 169, I voted no just simply because I didn't understand it. Otherwise, I probably would have voted for it. So my lack of intelligence is
duly noted.
Okay.
Supervisor Gerard.
Just a reminder, August 27th at Cronin's Golf Course is Cornell Cooperative Extension 7th Annual Golf Tournament that they use to raise funds for their operations. It's a great tournament. Cronin's does a great job, and any support they can get, especially from the supervisors. I know Mr. Sokol has been very supportive over the years. It is much appreciated. Thank you.
Any other announcements?
Wingfest down in Glens Falls, April 30th. Everybody should go down, take a look. Last year, the weather was great. Turnout was great. Great time to explore downtown.
Okay. Public comment.
Travis Whitehead, Queensbury. I just want to mention that for a couple weeks now, you've been operating without your first and only county administrator. And I know you're looking at replacing that position, but it also might be good to see how things work out for a while. But I want to acknowledge that, you know, there are some other people that are picking up some extra slack here, and you may want to consider maybe appropriating part of the savings that you're getting. I look at between salary and benefits, you're saving over $15,000 a month. Not filling that, and you might consider putting a portion of that, distributing it to people who are picking up the slack in various areas. I'm just suggesting you, in the course of the month at the subcommittees, you might want to bring this up. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else with Fred?
Very briefly, some years ago, there was a meeting of the county highway superintendents in Albany, and every superintendent of the county departments of public works and highways was at a meeting, and the subject came up about boards of supervisors versus boards of legislatures, and we had a vote. How many were in favor of the boards of supervisors? And a bunch of hands went up. How many were in favor of a board of legislatures? And the hands went up. Every superintendent that worked for a board of supervisors voted for the legislatures, and everyone that worked for a legislature voted for the board of supervisors. So welcome to the club.
Thank you, Fred. Any other words of wisdom? Motion to adjourn. Supervisor Simpson, second by Supervisor Dickinson. Thank you. Thank you. Good debate today. Good discussion.